Welcome back. Today it's time to put the .NET hat on because we're actually going to talk about top 10 C# developer mistakes. How many are you guilty of? Let's find out. They start off very simple and get super spicy, my favorite kind of coding content. Number one, we've got a method here that says throw if not Gary, and if the name isn't Gary, it's going to throw an exception. We've also caught it to write it out to the console. Now, I wonder if you can spot the issue with this. So if we go throw if not Gary and use the name Steve and run the app with a debugger, that's great. It says exception, not Gary. That's what we expected. But if we double check where it's actually throwing the exception, it's thrown it here on line 10, which is not where the exception happened. Now, if you had this in your app and you were looking at a stack trace on a logging system, you'd be in trouble here because the line number would be wrong. Absolutely, totally wrong. So what you need to do is stop this, close this, scroll up. And what we see here is people re-throwing the caught exception, which is not what you are supposed to do. You need to delete this. If you just do throw, look what happens. F5, not Gary, that's what we expect to see, but it's actually throwing the exception here where the original exception actually happened. So what you need to make sure you don't do is do throw exception within the catch block. You will get in trouble. Number one was eating exceptions and re-throwing them. On to number two. Imagine we have this asynchronous method that takes 100 milliseconds to run and then returns you a string. This could be calling an API, loading something from a database or something. Now, early on in your career, you might end up doing fetch data async dot results. This will work in a console app, but in an ASP.NET app, WinUI app, or a WPF app, this is bad news, okay? So one of the earliest mistakes that you need to watch out for is doing result, and you will do a wait like this. Goes without saying, probably know this already, should be careful. Number two was blocking on asynchronous code. On to number three. Now here's that method again. What we're going to do is change it from a task to avoid to demonstrate the problem here. This guy will throw an exception. What you might want to do is call the above method using something like this. We do try, and then you would just do fetch data async, like so. And your catch block might have something like this in it. And you go console.writeLine caught. Now the problem is, if you run this code, what you'll notice is that this will probably not get caught. You will not catch this exception. It's not going to happen. You cannot use async void in this way. It will not work as designed. You need to change it to a task, and then also await your method call like this. Now the only time this is acceptable is in UI frameworks for events. So you will see async void and something like button one click in UI frameworks like WPF or even our favorite .NET MAUI. Number three was misusing async void. Don't do that. On to number four. Take a look at this enumerable. We are going to return 1, 2, and 3, but we're actually going to write generating numbers when we actually access the enumerable. Now this enumerable could be reading files, lines from a file, be reading a database record, whatever. Here's a bit of code to demonstrate where you can go very wrong with this. And numbers here is going to be the unexecuted enumerable. And the question is, how many times is generating numbers going to be called? So what we can do is actually run the app and we'll see that generating numbers here is actually executed 3 times. And you might not want this, because if this was reading lines from a file, you'd actually end up reading the file 3 times, which is not what you want. So if we close this, we can see that here we're going to execute the list. Here we're going to do it again for count. And here we're going to do it when we iterate over numbers. Now, the way to fix this, obviously, is to call toList. So we don't do multiple enumerations. If we do Shift F5 again, this is what we want, okay? We've only actually gone through the list of numbers once, and this would save your file access or database row reading from being, well, rubbish. Number four was multiple enumerable enumerations. Be careful. on to number 5. Next up, let me show you the wrong way to write data to files. So imagine you had a stream writer like this, new stream writer file path like so, and you did writer.write content. Well, you might think it's that easy. The problem is this could leave the file handle open. It might close it though. It's totally unpredictable. A garbage collector might sort you out. Just, you can't write this. Now there are two ways to do this correctly. Let's copy and paste this method, move it down there. Let's make this safe like so. So what you can do, you can go using var writer is new stream path like this, like so. That is okay. That will make sure that the file handle gets closed when the method ends. But in C# 8, you can also just get rid of these brackets and do it that way. This means that the stream writer will close the file, dispose of everything when the method exits. So please do it this way. Don't do it that way. Yeah, nice. Number 5 was bad resource management by ignoring the using statement. Don't do that. On to number 6. So imagine we want to do string concatenation and make a comma separated list of every item in this items list of strings. Now this is one way you could do it, and I'll show you why it is particularly rubbish. Here is a test bit of code we wrote earlier. We're going to create a list of 100,000 Garys. We're going to create a stopwatch. We're going to then call this build string loop bad with the items here. Hit a stop on the stopwatch and then see how long it took to put this comma separated list of Garys together. Save that, hit F5, sit down, twiddle our thumbs. Bear in mind, this is a multi-core machine, super powerful. It took 5 seconds to put a comma separated list of the 100,000 instances of the name Gary, which is particularly rubbish. So if we want to speed this up, we need to stop doing string concatenation like this, which creates a new string every time it concatenates, filling my computer memory with the word Gary. Anyway, what we want to do is do var string builder is new system text.string builder like so. And for every item, we're going to append the name Gary here to the string builder. So append item like so, and we will return the string builder to string like so. And we'll rename this method to good because it's actually good, not bad. There you go, down there, and we're going to feed our 100,000 Garys in. Hit F5, run the app. 1 millisecond, that's 5,000 times faster. Number 6 was bad string concatenation. On to number 7. Here's an oldie but a goodie. Here we're using HTTP client to request a URL that's provided to this method. Now we're creating a new HTTP client and disposing it on every request using here. But what happens when we try to actually run thousands of these at the same time? Hit Shift F5. We are requesting stuff. We can look down there and fast forward a bit. It started erroring out here. It just doesn't like it after about 1,500 requests. Now you're supposed to reuse an HTTP client. That's what it's designed to do. So here we do HTTP clients, it's new HTTP client, like so. Get rid of this. Change HTTP client, get async, and reuse it. Let's call this safe, and call this good, because it's actually better. And that is much better code. Now, if you're doing this in ASP.NET Core, you would want to use something called an HTTP client factory. Look up how to use this if you want to do this in ASP.NET Core. Number 7 was not reusing HTTP client. Everyone will call you out for this one. On to number 8. Now let's talk about a little gotcha with actions and lambdas and variables. This one's a fun one. So we have create actions here, which creates 3 console write lines. You'd think this would print, well, what do you think this prints? Let's try out. So we can get the actions like this, create actions, and then for each var action in actions, run the action, like so. Run the app, and what we'll see here is it's actually printed value 3 times. That's not the expected result here. Now, the reason is that this lambda here has actually captured the I variable. Okay, and by the time this executes, I is already 3, and it's stayed there, it hasn't been garbage collected, it's still actually there. So when you run this app, you get value 3. So how do you fix this? Well, what we need to do is actually capture this variable into this loop. We can go var my number is I, grab my number, whack it in there. And if we run this code again that prints the action, like so, we should correctly get value 0, value 1, value 2, which was the value of my number at the time. This has created a new variable within the loop scope, so watch out for this one. Number 8 was accidental variable capture in lambdas. Don't do that. Next up, number 9. Here is some fun with structs and what you should not do with them. So here we have a point struct, and structs are not meant to change, but in theory you can actually do it. So if we do move, we're going to move the values of x and y plus or minus whatever you provide. So where can this get us in a pickle? Well, if we write a bit of code to alter the content of the struct. Now, we might think this works, yes? So we're going to print it out using the toString method here, even though we're going to call this move method, which should, in theory, alter the values here. That's what we think is going to happen, yeah? And then we're going to print it again. Well, watch what happens. Well, what happens is absolutely nothing. Before and after is still 0. Well, that's not right, is it? So the correct way to use structs like this is to actually make them immutable. Okay, so we're going to change this to immutable points, like so. Let's actually change the names, make it correct. So we're going to change the move method to actually return a new copy of itself, like so. So return new immutable points with x is x plus the offset and y is y plus the y offset that you've provided, like so. And we can then just call the move method moved points is like so, and we will write the new moved point out. Bang, there you go. So before and after has the correct result that we're expecting. Starts with 0, ends with 10, and we're using structs in the right way. Number 9 was misuse of structs. They're read-only, guys. On to number 10. Did you know that the C# compiler is not foolproof? You can actually write code that will compile but won't run. And yeah, it's pretty nasty. So this is a struct with a circular dependency of itself. Now we can write some test code for this circular dependency and see what happens. So at this point, it's going to get in trouble, right? So we've got some code here that is not going to run, we don't think. We can actually run the app and see what happens. Now, the compiler should tell you that I can't compile the app, but no, it's actually tried to run it, yeah? And we've got this system type load exception, could not load the generic struct from the assembly. Now, how would you fix this struct so you can actually access this default int without crashing the entire .NET runtime? Well, you'd have to do something like this, public static or glass defaults like this, do a nested class, whack that in there, and then you can do something like console.write line and do something crazy wild. Value is plus generic structs string dot defaults dot default int. You can't see that because it's underneath me. Default int dot value, like that. Run the app, and you should see struct has actually been created, and we got past the circular reference of generics. I hope that you've never run into that. A little gotcha. That's not very nice at all, is it? Number 10 was self-referencing static generic members that amazingly will do runtime errors, not compile errors. So how many of those were you guilty of? Please let me know in the comments. And if you want more C# coding content for a change, not just complaining about things. Please leave a like or subscribe to the channel for more C# content. Until next time.